unsure about whether to have the COVID vaccine or you're not sure what the benefits or what the need is. Hi, I'm Chevonne Risbrooke. I'm a fourth year medical student at the University of Birmingham. Today, I'm going to be speaking with Dr. Anthony Cox from the university's School of Pharmacy over Zoom. I'm going to try to ask him some of the millions of questions we have about having the COVID vaccine. So hi, Dr. Cox, how are you today?
Hello there, Chevonne. Fine, thank you.
So I'm looking forward to chat with you just to have a bit of idea about, to answer loads of questions about the COVID vaccine. So could you first tell us a bit about your background and how has this informed what you know about the COVID vaccine?
So I'm a registered pharmacist and in my previous life worked in the NHS as a hospital pharmacist and then moved into what we call a yellow card centre, which is a centre that helps encourage people to report the side effects of vaccines and other medicines to inform the safe use of those medicines. And while I was there, I did a PhD and then transferred into academia. So I'm now a reader in clinical pharmacy and drug safety and do my research and teaching around that area. So my background is around this sort of area of safety, but also I did used to spend a lot of time arguing with anti-vaccinators in the early 2000s as well when the MMR autism Andrew Wakefield thing was going on. So my interest in this sort of area is both professional and was sort of around that sort of early internet as well.
Well, thank you so much. So you're well capable of answering the load of questions that I have, I guess.
Well, we'll see.
So as we see the vaccination programs and vaccines are now being offered to younger individuals, so those between the age of 18 to 24, what is the latest advice about having the vaccine and which vaccine would you recommend this age group to be having?
So as the pandemic has evolved since the first vaccines were used in December, and things have changed a little. So the prevalence of COVID has fallen following the post sort of Christmas lockdown that we had. So that means that the risks have changed from COVID. And we've had developing information about the nature of the risks associated with some of the vaccines as well. So initially, for example, there was concern about anaphylaxis or like severe allergic reactions to the Pfizer vaccine just before Christmas. And those have sort of disappeared as we got more data. So initially we had a rule that you wouldn't use the Pfizer vaccine, for example, in those who had like a history of severe reactions to nuts, for example. But that advice has now changed because it's clear that that adverse reaction is a lot rarer than we thought and doesn't seem to be associated with other forms of allergy. So you have to be actually allergic to the actual vaccine itself, and that's very, very rare. But what we have learned over the past few months is that the AstraZeneca vaccine, for example, is linked to a fairly rare and unusual form of blood clots associated with thrombocytopenia, which is like reduced platelets within the blood. So people will get easily sort of develop bruising on themselves and possibly severe headaches and things. And these will be related to these strange clots that people have been reporting. And they're very rare, about 1 in 100,000 people. So that means as the prevalence of COVID has fallen and this risk has appeared with the AstraZeneca vaccine, that the harm benefits for that particular vaccine means it's preferable now for those under 40 and under 30 to have an alternative vaccine around either Moderna or the Pfizer vaccine. If the prevalence of COVID was still high, then the risk benefit would change again. And you could theoretically start using AstraZeneca again because the two risks start to balance out again. But because younger people are at less risk of COVID than older people, that harm benefit calculation is different. So that's what's changed. There's a preference towards giving the mRNA vaccines based around Pfizer and Moderna.
All right, thanks for letting us know that. So you mentioned something about risk benefit and especially how COVID impacts younger people differently. So as a young person considering getting the vaccine, considering the risk of COVID versus the benefit, why should a young person be vaccinated?
Okay, so well, it's not no risk at all. So there is the personal risk that you carry of developing COVID, and there are some serious outcomes in some individuals. So some people will end up in ITU on a ventilator who are young. It's not like 100% safe to catch COVID if you're young. So there are, and some of the more shocking stories I've heard from people I know professionally working in intensive care units have been, they've been personally shocked by the age of some people who have ended up in quite a serious condition. So it's not that there's no personal risk from COVID if you are young. So there is that side of things. And also, not all the risks of COVID are about hospitalization. There are short-term and medium-term risks, such as this concern about long COVID. And I know people personally who are still struggling with their sense of taste and smell months after an infection with COVID-19. And that is in its own way debilitating and actually has reduced the quality of their life. So there is a personal side to it. But then there's also the societal benefits that we can have from reduced transmission to our loved ones, reducing risk further for those who've in older age groups. There's an issue around our ability to open up society and go back to face-to-face teaching in a university context, but also things like festivals and rock concerts, travel. If you have the NHS app now, you can look at your COVID vaccination status, and there's a barcode there for proving your vaccination status for travel. So I think these things are other reasons to have the vaccine, as well as that general. Well, I mean, it's sort of an obligation we have to help society by helping build up that herd immunity to stop the transmission of the COVID-19 virus.
So thank you for that. So you mentioned herd immunity. Could you just tell us a bit more about herd immunity? And second part of the question is, if there is, because we're looking at the vaccination numbers and we're high in the amount of the population being vaccinated, so would someone really need to be vaccinated if we reach herd immunity already? What would be your thoughts on that?
Right, okay. So herd immunity, for example, is if you have a certain proportion of your population vaccinated. It depends on the nature of the disease, what level that would be, how infectious it is, for example. If you reach a certain level, it stops the transmission of the disease through the community and through society, because you have almost like, if you have a forest and there's a fire and you cut out a big section of the forest to stop the fire traveling to the next section of the forest, it's a bit like that. It's sort of preventing the movement of the disease through the population by not having individuals in a chain that can be infected. And so the more people you have vaccinated, the less likely it is that two unvaccinated people can meet. Now, there are people who can't be vaccinated in society who we have a sort of a moral obligation, is my belief, to protect. So the immunocompromised, there may be others who, like, for example, who have severe allergies to something that's within one of the vaccines. There are people who have reduced effectiveness of the vaccine as well because of their immune system. So those people are protected by herd immunity. Now, you could, for example, say, well, enough people have been vaccinated, so I don't see why I have to be vaccinated. But then if everyone thought like that, we would never reach herd immunity. So it is a sort of freeloader problem that you can sort of freeload on other people having the vaccines. However, these are extraordinarily safe vaccines with very, very rare side effects. The majority of the side effects are around things like having a sore arm for a couple of days, or fatigue, fever, chills. Sometimes people get headaches and dizziness, for example. Now, these sorts of things, it's like a flu-like syndrome, lasts for 24 to 48 hours. They're not much of a hardship to put up with for the wider benefits to society that herd immunity will bring.
Thank you so much. So, okay, I'm sort of sold. If I wanted to have the vaccine, how can I go about booking it?
Right, well, there's the NHS website, is absolutely excellent for booking that vaccination thing. So if you go there now, it's open to everyone over the age of 18. So use that. There is a, I think, phone number 119 as well you can use to book appointments. So it's a really easy process. There's like three things that stop people having vaccines. One is around sort of concern about safety and things. One is around sort of competence of the government and the healthcare system. And people have great belief in the NHS in the UK and the regulatory bodies that have been running the vaccine program. And then the other one is convenience. And in the UK, we don't really have a problem with that. It is essentially vaccination is free. And there's been great moves by the government to try and take vaccination out into the community. In Birmingham, for example, we've seen the use of mosques and as well as mobile buses going to particular areas to improve vaccine uptake. So there should be an option somewhere on the NHS website to help you get vaccinated wherever you're based.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Cox, for speaking to me. That was a lot of useful and insightful information, and I hope it helps inform others in deciding to get vaccinated.
Okay. Thank you very much, Siobhan. Great to speak to you. Thank you.